before I finish the speaker, I want to tell you about the next faculty seminar PEI. Simon Levin, the Buffett Professor of Biology, is going to talk about mathematical ecology, the century of progress and challenges for the next century on April 4th. Today we're fortunate to have Rob Nixon as our lecturer. Rob is the Currie and Thomas Barron Professor of the Humanities and the Environment. He's the first holder of that chair, the first appointee to the Humanities and PEI at Princeton. Before coming here in 2015, he was at Wisconsin Madison for 15 years and at Columbia College for 5 years. Rob has a first degree from Rhodes University in South Africa and then Columbia University, where he got his PhD. He's published several books. The latest is called Slow Violence and the Environmentalism of the Poor, published by Harvard Quincy Press. Got a number of prizes. If you go on the web, you see all kinds of interesting description and prizes for that book. Rob is interested in environmental studies, post-colonial studies. He's from South Africa. He's particularly interested in post-colonial issues, environmental justice and climate. So Rob has a peculiarity, which I've mentioned once before, on his CV. He says that he's given lectures on 6 continents. I knew a number of people here who work in Antarctica, and I actually invite Rob to give a lecture in Antarctica, so that's all continents. Michael, if you can travel, might get you in Antarctica. Now, I also want, before I start speaking, to mention something else. He's organized a series of lectures and movies for Global Perspective on Environmental Justice series. Starting on March 14th, he's a Monica White, who gives a lecture on food justice and black ag cooperative, etc., etc., a series of films, and finishing with a symposium on April 13th. Many of you may be interested in this. If you're posted, there are a number of flyers, and Rob would be happy to tell you what I can do. Rob Nixon.
Okay. Is that working? Is that good at the back? Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Francois. It's a great pleasure to be here, a great honor to be part of this series. And I thank everybody at PEI for making me so welcome, from the undergraduates through to the senior professors. It's a great delight to have this Environmental Humanities Initiative underway and to feel all the support that we've been given by the Barons and by everybody at the Institute. So my talk today is animated by 5 questions. The first question is this: what is the relationship between the sacrificial figure of the environmental martyr and the environmental sacrifice zones that have been proliferating across the planet under neoliberal globalization? The second question is, what is the relationship? The philosopher Kostika Bradetlan has asked a simple but very essential question: how is it that a corpse becomes a martyred body? What are the political and cultural processes of that transfiguration? And I want to take that question and direct it in a particular direction towards the figure of the environmental martyr at a time when, according to Global Witness, over the past decade, we've had an average of 2 environmental defenders, broadly construed, killed every week somewhere on the planet. The third animating question of my talk is, what is the relationship between the martyr and the movement, between the exceptional, elevated individual and the permeation of suffering, resilience, resistance across frontline environmental communities? The fourth question is, what is the mediating role of the environmental martyr between the living and the dead, and also between the human communities and more than human communities? In other words, embattled communities, often living in the forests, and endangered biotic communities. Finally, the fifth question that underlies my talk today is the question of, given that so many of these killings are occurring in the tropical forests and the subtropical woodlands, given that, in what way, what is the relationship between the figure of the fallen martyr and the figure of the felled tree? What is that relationship imaginatively, politically, spiritually, ethically? So at the outset, I wanted to make a few caveats. First of all, I don't want to romanticize or idealize the martyr as a great, exceptional, distant figure. The language, the idiom of martyrdom, the experience of martyrdom, coexists and must coexist with the language of assassination, targeted killings, eco-crime hotspots, a world of hitmen, and in some cases, ecocide. That said, what has really struck me is the way in which this idiom of martyrdom as a kind of imaginative and political court of appeal travels around the globe. One encounters it from Brazil to Indonesia, from the Philippines to South Africa, to Nigeria, to El Salvador, Costa Rica, Colombia, India, and so I'm Thailand, Cambodia. I'm interested in these half echoes around the figure of the martyrdom and what that implies. So most of the killings are around defenders of the forest, opponents of mining, and opponents of mega dams. But many of these struggles bleed into each other, so it's, for instance, not always easy to discern, and perhaps no reason to, what is the defense of a river and what is the defense of a forest because of the obvious ecological entanglement there. In addition to that, I would say that environmental defense is a very, very broad umbrella. So that in any given struggle, you may have a fight over the defense of the forest, water sovereignty, food security, land rights, and the respect for the dead. And sometimes those issues clash with each other. Sometimes they are convergent. But I very much take to heart what Audre Lorde once said, which is there's no such thing as a single-issue struggle because we do not live single-issue lives. And I think this is absolutely quintessentially true of these struggles that I'll be talking about today. So according to Global Witness, these are the most dangerous countries in which to operate as an environmentalist. And as I was saying, the rate of killings of people who are construed as environmental defenders is twice that of war correspondents. So it's an extraordinarily difficult and precarious situation that people find themselves in. So I sort of superimposed on the map the Global Witness put together this idea of environmental martyr belt, which is concentrated very much in the tropical forests of the world that girdle the midriff of the planet. Because I work in the humanities and because I'm always thinking about how do we communicate these issues, I wanted to read a quote from Ta-Nehisi Coates where he says, "Racism is a visceral experience that dislodges brains, blocks airways, rips muscle, extracts organs, cracks bones, breaks teeth. You must never look away from this. You must always remember that the sociology, the history, the economics, the graphs, the charts, the regressions all land with great violence upon the body." And this is true of the bodies in these environmental frontline situations, and particularly perhaps the indigenous body. So one of the things that impelled me to start thinking about this was a slew of films that have been made recently about environmental martyrs. This is I'm Chutvuti, Fran Lambrecht's film about the forest defenders in the Prelang forest in Cambodia. There's also Felipe Martinez's film set in Brazil called Toxic Amazon that focuses on Maria Santos and Zé Claudia de Ribeiro da Silva, a couple who were practitioners and advocates of agroforestry and created a kind of a nut business, but were also very active in protesting and engaging illegal loggers in the Amazon. Some of you may have heard of Berta Cáceres, a Honduran winner of the Goldman Environmental Prize in 2015, who was assassinated in Honduras in March last year. And she, her story is really of her involvement with the movement to protect the river that runs through the Lenca lands and Lenca forests from international developers. And they have had a great deal of success in getting the dam's international backers to secede from that project. And the fourth one is Shorebreak, set in the subtropical eastern seaboard of South Africa, again around a mining / forest and grassland struggle. So this is one of the cultural contexts that I'm thinking of. So I wanted to reflect a little bit more broadly about martyrdom, beyond environmental martyrdom, starting with Simone Weil's comment, "Death is the most precious thing that has been given to man. The supreme impiety is to make bad use of it." And this was written in the context of the French resistance to the Nazis in World War II. And so it's written in from a position of extremity. In the most extreme and traumatic situation, what is the difference between a meaningful and a less meaningful death? Now, this is protesters in the Narmada Valley in India, where they were the groups of people were threatened to stay put and be drowned if the dams were built, the so-called Martyrs Squad. And I should say, just as an aside here, that one of the difficulties of even talking about martyrdom at this moment is that it's so dominated in the contemporary media climate by ideas of Islamic extremism. And so trying to disengage our attention from that and refocus us onto this. So one of the things to think about is the tempo of martyrdom. We can think of examples of Tibetan monks self-immolating to protest Chinese occupation of Tibet, and Mohammed Bouzazi, the Tunisian vegetable vendor who set himself alight out of desperation in Tunisia and thereby helped spark the populist revolts across the Middle East. So there are these instances in extremity of people flaring into martyrdom in a desperate attempt to get some attention to the plight of the people around them. There are also, and this is unusual in environmental martyrdom, there are also these elongated forms of martyrdom where people over time stage a self-killing of some kind as a protest. More typically, this would be associated with hunger strikes. Bobby Sands and the IRA, probably most famously in Ireland. And in that context, often the authorities are very invested in not having that theater of suffering there as an ongoing kind of media magnet. And so, for instance, with some of the innocent people who have been kept in Guantanamo, there's been force feeding of the hunger strikers because people don't want that storyline, they don't want the deaths on their hands. But far more typically, in the context of environmental struggles in the global south, martyrdom comes with a bullet in the head. And in these contexts, almost every one I can think of, there's some kind of prefiguration. The people involved are aware of their profound vulnerability, of the heightened probability of assassination by some hitman. This is Ken Saro-Wiwa, who was one of nine people executed in 1995 by the Nigerian dictatorship at the time for protesting the despoliation by Shell and Chevron of the Niger Delta. And before he died, he said, "I am more dangerous dead." And there is often the sense of the projected power, posthumously, of these figures. This is his son writing, "My father hadn't been able to reach or influence a wider audience with his writing, but in dying for his people, he scripted the most compelling story of his life." So, coming back to this insistence on not romanticizing martyrdom, this is Gandhi: "Let us all be brave enough to die the death of a martyr, but let no one lust for martyrdom." And the case of Gandhi, in the case of Martin Luther King, case of many other political leaders, they were often subject to accusations of being in love with martyrdom, or having a martyrdom complex. That was one of the strategies that was wielded against them. And Chico Mendes, probably one of the most famous environmental martyrs: "I don't want anybody getting killed. There's no point in me or any of my colleagues dying. I don't think the dead bodies solve anything. And I know that if that's the way things go, this place will become an inferno." A prescient comment by him. So, these martyrs are connected to proliferating social movements among indigenous people and elsewhere. This is Not One More, which is a movement that started out of Cambodia. That's Chatvuti, the activist. And we have La Via Campesina, which has something like 200 million peasant and indigenous members across the world. The most difficult circumstances, these martyrs are connected very much to larger social movements. The bonfire regulations, that's a phrase by George Monbiot, which I think very much describes this political moment. And I wanted to reflect briefly on this question of lawlessness. Those of you, particularly the older members of the audience, may recall Edward Abbey as, at one point, a very influential figure in American environmentalism. And his 1975 novel, The Monkey Wrench Gang, gave rise to the term monkey wrenching, which is illustrated in the cover of the novel, which was nonviolent civil disobedience that targeted infrastructure. And the idea was to protect wilderness by putting sugar in the gas tanks of bulldozers and bobcats, pulling up surveyor stakes, attacking pylons, obstructing roads. So the idea was that infrastructure was bad, was a threat to the wilderness. Why this is relevant to my talk today is for two reasons. First of all, Abbey's thinking very much inflected Earth First and the movement to protect the hardwood forests in the American Northwest, the Redwood Summer and many other activities there in defense of the forest. But what's significant here is that these were acts of civil disobedience, of law breaking, in order to defend the environment. Whereas if we look at the cases, say, of Chatvuti or Maria Santos and de Ribeiro in Brazil, they are in fact acting as defenders of the law, where the laws are nominally on the books, but those supposedly defending them are either turning a blind eye or in the pay. Effectively, they're kind of state-sponsored vigilantes masquerading as police or militias. So I think it's a significant part of the story that any number of these environmental martyrs are actually defending laws that are otherwise undefended in relation to social movements. So, for instance, in Prelang Forest, where Chatvuti and his organization work. A lot of the subsistence came from the resin tree, from the trees. There was the self-perpetuating income from the resin trees. And so they were very opposed to the one-off felling of the hardwood trees in relation to this ongoing subsistence culture. And so one of the things that they did is they would listen for the sound of the chainsaw, and when they heard the chainsaw, they'd get on their scooters and surround people and, at great risk, confiscate the chainsaws. So you have photos of them with many, many, many chainsaws around. The word martyr is rooted in the Greek for witnessing. And so martyr is witnessing through the body, but also what's quite striking in many of these cases is photographic witnessing. Chutwoody was never without his cannon. Even in the logo of the movement, he had the cannon over his arm. And so he was obsessive in documenting the illegal logging. Marie Santo and Zé Claudio Ribeiro da Silva from Toxic Amazon operated in a similar fashion. They also listened for the chainsaws. When they heard the chainsaws or the logging trucks come, Zé Claudio would accost the driver, try to engage them, try to talk about the issue, and Maria Santos in the background would be taking the photographs of the vehicles and the logs. And they were killed in an ambush in 2010. I want to move on to this question of the martyr and the movement and the paradox of ordinary martyrdom. Berta Cáceres, the Honduran activist, here is accepting the Goldman Environmental Prize, which I'm sure many of you have heard of, that is given to environmental activists, particularly in the Global South and in minority communities and poor communities in the U.S. and elsewhere. And something really struck me when I was listening to her acceptance speech, and she said, I'm dedicating my prize to all the martyrs, to the river and to the forest. To all the martyrs, to the river and to the forest. And so it's both the sense of collective martyrdom beyond any individual, and one that includes these animate forces beyond the human. We see this recurring again and again in the struggles. This is from an El Salvadorian t-shirt protesting assassination of anti-mining activists. The environmental martyrs of Cabañas, those who die defending their people, are not dead. The sense of the unnamed or the little known martyrs, a reconfiguration of the idea of the martyr as an exceptional figure. And this is from Colombia. It's a call to meet for Environmental Martyrs Week, you know, again in the collective, again fairly anonymous. This is from the Philippines, a shrine dedicated to all the heroes and martyrs of the mining struggle. Assassination without elimination, the persistence of the dead. And this is a fine line to walk, to face the horrors of what's going on, and also to talk about different spiritual valences that the martyrdom has in these contexts. And so I wanted to read a quote that I think is very pertinent to this situation from the great and recently deceased John Berger. The living reduce the dead to those who have lived, yet the dead already include the living in their own great collective. Until the dehumanization of society by capitalism, all the living awaited the experience of the dead. It was their ultimate future. By themselves, the living were incomplete. Thus, living and dead were interdependent, always. Only a uniquely modern form of egoism has broken this interdependence, with disastrous results for the living, who now think of the dead as the eliminated. And if you look at where these frontline environmental struggles are occurring, whether in Catholic or Protestant or Muslim or Buddhist or Hindu cultures, there are very, very different valences to this idea of martyrdom. But this idea that the dead are not eliminated is a very critical and recurrent one. And it's very different from the kind of Western, the secular view within parts of the West that the dead are gone in some sense. And so the politics of the persistence of the dead in the landscape is a vital aspect of the story. And the film I'm Chatvuti comes from the slogan of the movement he was involved in after he was assassinated, that people would carry the signs of identification, of proliferation. After the beheading of the movement, this insistence that the life of the movement did not end. We see something very similar with Berta Cáceres and the movement around the Lenca and other indigenous peoples in Honduras. This idea of incorporation of the living into the dead and vice versa. Frequently, the protesters will use these masks, perhaps for combination of anonymity and identification. And the protests against her death occurred in indigenous communities across the Americas, places like Nicaragua and here Colombia. This is in Bogota, literally written on the body, the identification with the martyr and the proliferation of the movement through the embodied identification with the suffering. Similar in Nigeria, this idea of the persistence of the dead can have a double valence. On the one hand, the dead are not eliminated. On the other hand, the dead are also incorporated into the body of the movement itself. Berta Cáceres, presente, Chico Mendes, vive. And here the sign reads, she is present in the soul of our rivers and in the spirit of our birds. She's present in the soul of our rivers and the spirit of our birds. This idea of permeation and permanence, assassination without elimination, and the porousness of presence that goes beyond the human. One should also mention the movement across Southeast Asia of the so-called ecology monks. So one of the strategies that's been used in a variety of countries and a variety of forests, endangered forests there, is an attempt to slow deforestation through the ordination of trees. So the trees are inducted into the monastic community in the hopes of conferring on them heightened protection. These are ecology monks operating in the Nigala forest in Sri Lanka. So symbolically, it upgrades the severity of the assault on the tree, so that the man wielding the chainsaw is effectively creating a kind of a surrogate martyr, human by through. Through the humanizing of the tree. And I wanted to, you know, come back to a couple of these reflections of these martyred leaders about intersectionalism, which is such a critical part of this. Chico Mendes saying, "At first I thought I was fighting to save rubber trees, then I thought I was fighting to save the Amazon rainforest. Now I realize I'm fighting for humanity." Berta Cáceres, nearly 30 years later, "Giving our lives in various ways for the protection of the rivers is giving our lives for the well-being of humanity and of this planet. Our Mother Earth, militarized, fenced in, poisoned, a place where basic rights are systematically violated, demands that we take action." I wanted to end with a quote from James Baldwin from I'm Not Your Negro, which is showing at the Garden Theatre, and a really remarkable film. "You can't change everything you face, but you can't change anything without facing it." And I think this is a critical part of these struggles. And a component of that facing is the work that's been done by artists in relation to the deforestation crises across the globe. This is by Pejak, called Free Yourself. And what we see here is the limbs of the body politic attacking the environmental roots of the civic body, in a sense. It's a kind of self-slaughter. The agony and self-destructiveness of that. And I want to end with this image by the Spanish street artist and graffiti artist called Sam Three, which I think is a powerful image of the mindless surface act, the self-decapitation. And so you have this hybrid figure of the tree and the human and the sense of buried consequences that are biological and arterial and geological and the consequences of the kind of species extinction effectively, or the ripple effects down through time of these of the mindless surface acts. So I'll leave it there, and I'm happy to field questions. Thank you. Yeah. Right. Right. Yes. Sorry, the heroes who aren't heroes?
Well, the media, politicians,
right. Yeah. Would. Right. I think there is. I mean, there's a challenge around the exceptionalizing of the one life. And we've been talking about this in the Nexus course and elsewhere. The question of synecdoche. We all have sort of compassion fatigue or limits to our empathy. We struggle with the challenges of scale. Whether we're trying to think about glacial melting or we're trying to think about climate change. And often the only way we can channel our empathy is through something smaller, more manageable, that deputizes for the larger whole. And so I think this deputizing is going on all the time. So people in the movement will often see this person was killed, but all these other people were killed as well. But outside, like, why should I care about what's going on in Honduras? Well, there's a life, there's an individual life, and that's partly, I think, to do with the individualization of identity that is not universal but is increasingly pervasive. I was listening to BBC World Service one day, and I was a Peruvian activist from the Amazonian part of Peru was talking, and he had been a survivor of an attack that had killed, I think, five anti-logging activists. And he made a remark. He was talking anonymously. He made a remark that really resonated for me. He said, those people were dead to the eye before they were killed. Those people were dead to the eye before they were killed. The sense that there's a great awareness that if you kill a German in the Amazon, it'll be all over the world. If you kill an indigenous protester, that's a disposable life. And that those people are already dead to the eye. So part of the strategic challenge is how to make people visible, but then sometimes it involves buying in, as you say, into an idiom of heroism and exceptional individual. And these people are exceptional, but they're not perhaps as segregated from social forces as our media might typically portray. I don't know if that answers your question. Alan.
Thanks for a fascinating presentation. I wonder about the term martyrdom. Mm-hmm. You mentioned that it's been appropriated in different ways in different communities.
Yeah.
But I also wonder about the kind of Christian overtones and universalizing implications of the term.
Yeah.
makes me wonder whether you've encountered pushback on the use of that term.
Right.
I'm also thinking about how martyrdom, at least in Christian traditions, is closely associated with the idea of sacrifice.
Mm-hmm.
And could the term be appropriated by those who destroy as an idea of necessity, the necessary sacrifice?
Yeah.
No. Right.
I think, you know, there's two ways of looking at this. One is the idea of martyrdom does potentially take the destruction into a broader religious context where people who may not care about the environment are engaged by martyrdom. In other words, stewardship and protectiveness and so forth. Because so many of the killings have been focused in Latin America and Central America, I mean, obviously that Christian current is very, very profound. But it's also there differently inflected in Cambodia, Nigeria also, another Christian country. But it moves across religions, and obviously it changes. The idea of the afterlife, for instance, is profoundly different across these religions. But I think what's important, the anthropologist Anna Ting says, the dead are also social. The dead are also social. And one of the things that martyrdom does convey is the sense of the social continuity between the living community and the dead. So there are situations where you might say, well, is this idealizing suffering or forbearance or so forth? But the situations that I'm seeing it in, that's why I don't want it to be a standalone discourse. I want to talk about assassination. I want to talk about hit squads. I want to talk about the economics. And in looking at these killings, what I detect is two strands of thought, or two approaches that often are not in communication with each other. One is a critique of neoliberal globalization, and another is a kind of religious reading of supreme suffering and so forth. And so what I'd like to do is to try to bring together neoliberalism and the numinous. Like, how do we think through those together? Because we can impose our secular, I'm sure that many people in the room are not secular, but there are secular approaches that sideline the whole question of spirituality. And I think spirituality permeates so many of these struggles. So how do you incorporate it without playing into the very dangers that you're pointing out? Yeah.
First of all, I love between the world and me, and I love that quote. So
okay.
My question is about, you use the word intersectionality. Usually we use that in the context of gender and race relations.
Right, yeah.
I think that's not what you're getting at.
No.
So I was wondering what your use of the word is.
Yeah, I think it has multiple uses. I mean, we can have class intersectionality with class, with religion, with disability. I mean, there are so many variants of that. And I think in the context, one of the encouraging things that's happening, I think, is the strengthening of the environmental justice movement as an intersectional space where race, class, gender, religion, region, all of these issues come together, and so that you can look at the sort of unequal burdens, health burdens of women working in the home in India in relation to air pollution or particulate matter. You can look in another context about environmental racism and the dumping of toxins in rural North Carolina, say, which was one of the beginnings of the term environmental racism in the early 80s here. So I think intersectionality or intersectional thinking is not the preserve of you know, a limited number of categories. I think we can keep moving those categories. But maybe I sort of come from a background where those struggles have been fought out in post-colonial context. You know, somebody says, oh, it's all about race, or it's all about the nation, or it's all about gender, or it's all about this. And in these spaces, you're getting some circumstances where one aspect of that struggle is foregrounded, other circumstances where other aspects. So some people might declare themselves to be environmentalists, partly because they realize that's a term that the West recognizes, and you can get support, perhaps, and aid for that. But they might just think of themselves as concerned about land tenure, primarily. You know, so I think the plasticity of intersectional thinking is kind of critical to this. Yeah.
Thanks a lot, Robert. That's all really interesting. And one thing that the main thing was when you mentioned Bobby Sands and the strike, yeah. I actually thought that you mentioned the Ogoni 9 was the Ross Port 5. So
yes.
The West Coast of Ireland, the Shell pipeline.
Right.
And one tension that you're kind of getting at with the issue around martyrdom as well is that that particular movement, I think, one of several groups, I think, did actually visit them.
Yes.
There we go. I'm just wondering if you can kind of speak to I'm just curious that this cross between, say, movements where
right.
the stage isn't talking about, like, the stage isn't right. talking
yeah.
right. about the martyr in yeah. that regard.
No, I think that's a really good point. So, as I mentioned, Ken Sorowiwa was one of nine activists, Ogoni activists, who was executed by the Abacha regime because the National Nigerian Petroleum Corporation was 50-50 in with Shell, and they didn't want this disruption, these protests in the Niger Delta. But what's quite remarkable, what Michael's referring to here, is that in Rossport, in the west coast of Ireland, in a poor part of Ireland and in a kind of estuarine community dependent on fishing, people were opposing the lack of an environmental impact report. The Shell was coming in, and they were worried about gas flaring, the effects on farming, on the commons, on the air, and so forth. And they put up this mural of Ken Sorowiwa. And that's one of his poems translated from Ogoni into English and now into Gaelic. And these are the Ogoni 8 that were executed with him. So there was a sense of transnational identification, what Anat Singh calls traveling allegories. You know, and you find these people like Wangari Maathai or Ken Sorowiwa or Chico Mendes who resonate, and maybe in Indonesia, maybe in South Africa, maybe in Costa Rica. But I thought that was a really profound, I mean, you might want to add something more about that, but I think that's a really profound example of different communities who might have nothing to do with each other trying to strategize against a common adversary that's much more powerful, often even than the nations they're operating in. Yeah.
That tension, I suppose, about also like my, I think there is a tension in the alliance is built
yes.
in terms of the levels of violence being spoken.
Right.
Violence, yeah.
Yes, I agree. Yeah. Oh, sorry, of what?
You discussed the idea of monkey wrenching.
Oh, yeah.
There's this tension between the duty to uphold the law and the duty to fight against unjust laws.
Right.
And I'm just curious what you if you could elaborate a little bit on the implications of taking these actions when they're legal versus illegal,
right.
and what it means for these actions as a strategy.
Yeah. You know, the sort of borderline case was the spiking of trees in Redwood Summer in the Redwoods there. I think within the tradition of civil disobedience, there are different currents themselves that move, some that would advocate when the laws are so extreme, for instance, in Nigeria, you know, under authoritarianism, and we don't know what direction this country is moving in as well, at what point do the laws require more than, you know, more than conventional civil disobedience? While I'm totally opposed to violence against people, what we have seen is very imaginative strategies, creative strategies, of preventing business as usual. And I think this stretches from the Niger Delta to the redwood forests. And we think, you know, I didn't have time to really talk about it, but the tree sitting in the redwood forest, and somebody like Julia Butterfly Hill, who came to symbolize this in the late 90s, and there were attempts to blow her out of the tree by helicopter and so forth. I mean, there was a lot of violence directed even at those protesters in a democratic state. So in these other circumstances, one has to take into account that the epidemic of killings is also accompanied by an epidemic of impunity. I mean, it's hardly ever that anybody is prosecuted, and the people who are being prosecuted are typically very poor, and they're the local hitmen. Okay, so then the government can say, "Well, we dealt with it," you know. But the hierarchy of power is much harder to tackle from the ground up, and that's where I think international alliances are so crucial. Yeah, I think it comes back to the first question, really, this idea of the individual life, the biographical impetus. And in at least three of the four films, there is a focus on an individual or a couple and following their trajectory. In the fourth film, The Shore Break in South Africa, it's a little more about the movement and the different politics of that. But I think it's kind of ineluctable in a way that the life story of somebody persisting under such duress is just a very powerful medium. And so the challenge then is to try to hook into that structure information about the political and economic conditions, rather than starting in the abstract, laying out those conditions and then mentioning a whole lot of individuals that we don't get a kind of fleshly sense of. I just think that's absolutely inevitable in terms of trying to interest people in what may seem like far remote struggles that we shouldn't care about. I also think that this question of analogy is very important, that people can analogize. And we've seen this, for instance, with Black Lives Matter and We Can't Breathe, how that trope of We Can't Breathe has been picked up and used by graffiti artists in Cape Town, in Delhi, in Jakarta. It has a political and physiological resonance for so many people who are living claustral existences and are perhaps struggling with the density of particulate matters in the air, but also struggling with police brutality. And so that's partly what I'm interested in, is the circulation of these stories. And it's just a moment where there are these martyrdom films, and one of them, in the case of Shore Break, is sort of anticipatory, that one of the key figures in the film was killed maybe 3 months after the film was completed, before it was distributed. But the sense heroism is a compromising word in some ways, but I think the depth of commitment and the way that that expands our spectrum of what it means to be environmentally committed, I think is a powerful allure. Yeah. Yeah.
And Jesus Christ was crucified on a tree. He was buried. He died.
Yeah.
And rose again.
Yes.
And lives forever.
Yeah. No, I think in Brazil, in the case of let me just see if I have. This is an image of Zé Claudio, the Brazil nut tree, and this posture really interests me as expressive of amazement, pride. There's a sort of physical, tactile connection to the girth of the tree. But it's also, I mean, 6 months later he was ambushed and killed. Also, retrospectively, it's kind of a posture of crucifixion. You know, he's nailed himself to the tree. And I should say that in the long tradition of tree hugging, going back at least till 1730 in India, people typically don't hug the tree, they back into the tree, you know, so that they can interact with whoever is attacking the tree. So it's a slight misnomer, but this is a sort of tree-hugging posture, and there is something of the, not only the protectiveness, but I think the intimate physiological connectedness in this image, but also that foreshadowing. And I think English is not alone in having all of this metaphoric connection between trees and humans. You know, we talk about the crown of the tree and the limbs of the tree. We talk about people as being rooted and uprooted. And there's this constant, going back to Ovid's Metamorphosis and probably in other cultures even before that, this constant sense of the treeness of humans and the humanness of trees. It's a very, very powerful, powerful current. Yeah. Thank you. Yes. Yes. Right. Yeah. Now that's a very good question. So, I sort of wrote about that in the book Slow Violence, where I was interested in how can we rethink violence away from the spectacular and the immediate, and the attritional violence. And so I think a lot of poor communities do feel that they have become sacrifice zones, and that they, as communities, are being sacrificed, but over the long term. So even far longer than the duration of, say, a hunger strike, we're talking about intergenerational impacts of Agent Orange, say, for example, and that those, in a sense, it would be hard to perceive them as martyred, but it would certainly be easy to see them as sacrificed communities, and you might want to expand that to martyrdom. But that's definitely been a key element in my work, is trying to think through situations where sometimes accidentally, but sometimes strategically on the part of corporations or governments, they say, well, in 20, 30 years' time, nobody will even know where this came from. They won't know the history of it. And so as a public health issue at the cusp, where public health and environmental concerns meet, I think often you've got these situations you're describing. Yeah. Yes.
You gave three examples, I think it was three, maybe it was two, of the link between awakening and martyrdom. Right?
Yeah.
So my first thing, I thought it was not the world, and I thought it was not the world.
Yeah. Yes.
And messaging about martyrdom. And
yeah.
To what extent is the pervasiveness and the compelling nature of narratives about martyrdom a way to create awakening in the
yeah.
world?
Right, in a population that's unaffected by these particular struggles. Yes, yes, absolutely. So, for instance, Ken Saro-Wiwa in Nigeria said he couldn't get any traction for the suffering of his people in the Niger Delta, which was connected to the despoilation of the mangrove forests and the waters and the fishing grounds and so forth. Okay. Then he came to America and he saw the success of a anti-logging campaign in Colorado, and he said, okay, if I reframe what's going on as a human rights struggle and an environmental struggle, maybe people listen. And they did. So he understood that to get a Western audience, he had to reframe it not as a struggle for the Ogoni people, which people may, you know, don't know who the Ogoni people are and so forth. So this language of awakening that you talk about, I think, is very important, and it interests me in the second example, Berta Cáceres, where she's very insistent on describing the world, the violated world, in which this awakening is occurring. So part of the challenge is to universalize without starting from the universal. You know, incorporating voices so that people can say this matters, but not that, oh, we're all environmentalists and we're all in it together. Well, we're not. You know. And so I think one of the things that the environmental justice movement's trying to do, one of the things that these films are trying to do, is to give texture to the inequities within those struggles. And from my point of view, you know, we've seen so many millions of people lifted out of poverty, but we have seen this vast, vast chasm opening between the ultra-rich and the mega-poor. And in the US today and elsewhere, the kind of hollowing out of the middle. And so I think the rise in economic inequality in conjunction with the rise of environmental crisis, those two are really inseparable. And this awakening is partly how do we think in planetary terms, but also in a contrapuntal way that takes us back to these textured lives that are very different from our own, but with whom we may have some overlapping values. Yeah.
Francois asked me to bring this to the
class. Oh, yeah. Okay.
Because Rob has a class at 1:30, and so...
Okay, thank you.